Good morning, everyone. We've had such interactions in the past as well. So, anyways, a little delay in starting. So, we'll start straight away with the presentation on laparoscopic surgery. So, again, I'm sorry for the delay, but it's always a pleasure interacting with the young minds, young innovative minds of IIT Ropard. So, starting with the presentation, I hope the echo is not there now. Can you hear me loud and clear?
Yes, sir, you are audible clear.
Yeah, okay. So, friends, science is, it's always been evolving over the years. And we should be thankful to our predecessors and the various scientists and the innovators, especially the biomedical engineering people who have developed all those innovations and instrumentations, which have made our lives and the patient's life very easy. So those who forget their past are condemned to repeat it. So you should always remember our predecessors, our scientists who have worked so hard with these. Coming on to the history of laparoscopic surgery, it was Philip Bozzini of Austria who was the first to examine the urethra of a patient using a simple tube and a candlelight. And later on, they were able to develop the early cystoscopes. George Kaelling was the first to do a cholecystectomy in a living dog in 1902. And Jacobius presented a series of patients in 1910, a series of 100 laparoscopic and thoracoscopic surgeries. So he was the first one to present a series. And coming on to the history of laparoscopic surgery, it was Kurt Simm, who was actually a gynecologist. And during one of those diagnostic laparoscopies, he encountered an inflamed appendix. And in fact, literally, he improved, he was able to remove that appendix. And he was the first one to perform a laparoscopic appendicectomy. So incidentally, the first laparoscopic appendicectomy was performed by a gynecologist in 1982. It was Philip Moret who performed the laparoscopic cholecystectomy in 87. And in India, Thampton Ulwadia from Bombay was the first one to do a laparoscopic cholecystectomy. And in Ropard, we did our first cholecystectomy in 1995 by Dr. R.S. Parmar. Well, there have been three revolutions in surgery. The first one was, of course, asepsis, then anesthesia, and the third one was laparoscopy. Asepsis, we all know, once we had those antibiotics, we had those sterilization equipments and so much, we were able to perform various surgical procedures with safety. And similarly, anesthesia was required in performing all kinds of surgeries, because prior to anesthesia, it was just a vocal anesthesia, or there was a lot of pain and the patient was under a lot of stress while undergoing the surgery. So the smooth induction and smooth recovery has done wonders with the patients. And the third one was laparoscopy, which is again an innovation in which the surgical procedure has become so simplified and patient-friendly that we do not have to open up the abdomen. You can operate through those small keyholes, and the patient's recovery becomes faster and it's more comfortable for the patient as well as the surgeon. So laparoscopic surgery is also called a keyhole surgery, a minimal invasive surgery, or minimal access. They're all the same. The principal difference between the laparoscopy and open surgery, we all know that the postoperative pain is of course related to the incision, and the smaller the incision, there is lesser the amount of pain. There is less handling of the intestines, which is called a paralytic ileus. So whenever we do an open abdominal surgery, we handle the intestine. That handling of the intestine results in a lot of ileus. That means the bowel gets swollen, and it takes around 48 hours for the bowel to move again. That is for the peristalsis to come back. So since there is a very less amount of handling of the intestine in laparoscopic surgery, so paralytic ileus is much less. The patient can eat early generally by evening we start orals and the next day patient goes home. Whereas in open surgery, generally the oral intake is started after 2 days. So, of course, you can avoid trauma to the abdominal wall, injury in seals, and there is a rapid return to the normal activity. So the initial capital cost is a little more as compared to open surgery, but there is a reduced overall cost because of a shortened hospital stay and a fast recovery and your return to your job and work. You get a much more magnified view as compared to an open surgical procedure. In open surgery, the bigger the incision, the better the view that you get. But in a laparoscopic surgery, you can, you know, go to all the nooks and corners of the abdomen through that telescope. You can go above the liver, you can go behind the liver, you can go behind the bowel, you can go into the pelvis, behind the uterus, and go anywhere where you like with that long telescope. But this is not possible in an open surgical procedure because the surgery of the pelvis becomes very, very difficult because the visual, your view is much more limited because you can't reach those deep places in the pelvis. So, but there is always an altered tactile sensation in a laparoscopic procedure, which is a plus point of an open surgical procedure because whenever you're doing a solid organ surgery, like you're operating upon a spleen or kidney or a liver, so if you can have a tactile response from that solid organ mass, it is always better. But this is a limitation of laparoscopic surgery. So you can't say it is totally absent, but it is an altered tactile sensation. You don't get a three-dimensional view, you get only a two-dimensional view, which can be a little troublesome for the beginners. But once you become a little more experienced, you get accustomed to that two-dimensional view. But nowadays we have 3D cameras as well, in which you can have a three-dimensional view of the abdomen. So usually they say the longer operating time, but again, I would say with experience that operating time becomes much more shorter, in fact, much shorter than an open surgical procedure. So you have to develop an entirely different operating technique. Actually, the surgical principles, they remain the same for every surgery, be it laparoscopic surgery or an open surgical procedure. But obviously your technique is a little different. You have to have, precise hand movements. You are seeing on a screen and operating upon a patient, and which is not there in an open surgical procedure. So you are looking somewhere else and doing some surgeries somewhere else. Instrumentation, of course, the open surgical instruments are smaller, but laparoscopic instruments are much longer because they have to go through those trocars and ports. So generally they are around 15 to 18 inches in length as compared to 6 to 10 inches of open surgical instrument. So these are the basic equipments which you require. You require a good camera, a light source, insufflator. Insufflator is a device which insufflates carbon dioxide into the abdomen. So why we use the carbon dioxide? Because why can't we use air? Generally, it is seen that the air is combustible, and once you are using electrocautery and performing those surgeries, there is always a chance of inflicting burns inside the body of the patient. So carbon dioxide is an inert gas. There have been studies with the nitrogen oxide as well, nitrous oxide as well. But they've seen that once you use nitrous, the bowel becomes too bloated and it becomes very difficult to handle. So CO2 they found to be the best gas because it gets absorbed as well. The chances of air embolus are much less as compared to carbon dioxide. So that's why CO2 is the gas, it's a gas of choice for laparoscopic surgery. So you should have a TV monitor, which can be a LED, which can be any of the monitors, a telescope, which can be a 0-degree telescope, a 30-degree telescope, 45-degree telescope, depending upon the kind of surgery you want to go, and a light cable. So these are the instruments that we use during these surgeries. These can be reusable instruments, these can be disposable instruments. Generally, we prefer using the reusable instruments because you can re-sterilize them. The cost of surgery comes down once you are using the disposable instruments. Obviously, you have to throw them off after every surgery, which becomes very cumbersome. So nowadays, we have autoclavable instruments. You can autoclave each and every part of this instrument. Initially, the plastic parts were not autoclavable, and we had to put them in a glutaraldehyde solution to sterilize these instruments. But with the new instruments coming up, we can autoclave each and every part. They are available in, 5 millimeter is the diameter. It can be 10 millimeter instrument, the length can be 30, 36, or 43 centimeters. 43 centimeters is the size of instruments which are used for morbidly obese patients during the bariatric surgical procedures. So cameras, again, we have various kinds of cameras, single chip cameras, 3-chip cameras, high definition, and the latest is a 3-dimensional 3D camera. And light source, of course, so we have a halogen light source and a xenon light source. Xenon light source is a cold light, but still it can cause burns, so we shouldn't be very casual while using these light sources. And xenon light source is the closest to the sunlight. Once you are using a halogen light source, there is a lot of yellowness in the light that you get, but in a xenon light source you get white light. So as I said, CO2, again, the gas of choice because it has the same refractive index as air, so it doesn't distort the image and is non-combustible. So generally, we keep the intra-abdominal pressure between 10 to 13 millimeters of mercury. And there are various high flow insufflators as well, where we require high flow of the gas in an obese patient. TV screen, standard TV, can also be used, but then the clarity is much less as compared to a medical grade monitor, because in a medical grade monitor, there are more lines of resolution and you can get a better picture detail. As I said, coming on the various laparoscopes, you can have a 5 millimeter and a 10 millimeter laparoscope. 10 millimeter laparoscopes, they give you a bigger view as compared to 5 millimeter laparoscope, but for a 5 millimeter laparoscope, you require a 5 millimeter trocar, so the size of incision decreases if you are using a smaller laparoscope. So it is made up of a rod lens system. Again, wide range of angles depending upon your choice. They can also be autoclavable. Reusable take-apart instruments are the preferred instruments nowadays. You can put them in an ultrasonic washer or enzyme preparation to clean the muck which is stuck to these instruments or the crevices of these instruments. And that once that muck goes off, then they are ready for sterilization. So these are the various hand grip types, the pistol grip types with the ratchet. Ratchet is a lock. So once you want to hold something and keep it as such, you can put in a ratchet. Otherwise, you don't require a ratchet. So Maryland forceps is used for dissection. It can be a curved Maryland. It can be a right angle forceps, again depending upon where you want to do the dissection. You can have a blunt dissector, you can have a grasper. Grasper is a tooth grasper which has tooth over its ends for a better grip. And then you can have a right angle instrument as well. These are the various retractors. A hook is used to, again, for dissection. And you can have a suction nozzle, you can have a needle holder. Needle holder can also be a straight and a curved one. So again, coming on to the cleaning and disinfection of instruments, so there is a difference between sterilization and disinfection. Sterilization takes care of the mycobacteria or the all kinds of spores as well. But in disinfection, at times the rigid spores are not killed. So sterilization is considered better than disinfection. Disinfection is it's a chemical disinfection, and sterilization is done with the help of autoclave. So again, the gold standard is autoclaving. But in a routine laparoscopic surgery, you can disinfect these instruments by putting them in Cydex or glutaraldehyde, as we know it. You need to, dismantle all these instruments and place them in an enzyme solution. And once the muck or the grease goes off the instruments, you clean them, wash them, and then put them after drying. Of course, after drying these instruments, you put them in a Cydex chamber, which you can see at the lower end. So there should not be any cluttering of instruments, as you can see in this picture. So the right way is to have minimum amount of instruments in a chamber. You can have multiple chambers. So this glutaraldehyde needs to be changed between 7 to 14 days, depending upon your caseload. So generally what we have a policy of changing glutaraldehyde after every 7 days. But in most of the hospitals, the glutaraldehyde suffices for 15 days. Again, autoclaving, you can make such sets in metallic trays and then autoclave these instruments in a autoclave. And this can be used within 48 hours. Whatever you can't autoclave, like these tubes, these cables, or the plastic parts, they can be etiosterilized. So this is the ethylene oxide chamber, which is a gas which sterilizes these plastic instruments. And these were very prevalent, these formalin chambers. Many of you might have seen these kind of chambers in which they put in formalin tablets to sterilize this or to disinfect these instruments. But the problem with these formalin chambers is that nothing is standardized. We don't know how many tablets are required to disinfect a particular amount of instrumentation. How long will it take for these formalin tablets to disinfect a particular set of instruments? Every time you open up the chamber, take out a few instruments and then replace them back, there is always a breach in sterilization. So in fact, formalin chambers are nowadays it's not recommended actually. So the gold standard is autoclave, otherwise it's a etiosterilization or glutaraldehyde. Coming on to the electrocautery, there can be
on the sterilization side, does eutherization has any role in any place?
Pardon?
On the sterilization side, does the UV sterilization, ultraviolet sterilization, UVC yes. sterilization, has yes. it any role anywhere?
Yes, UV sterilization, of course, it can be used. I don't have any experience with it, but definitely it is being used in a few of the centers. But again, the cost of sterilization will go high.
Okay.
But definitely, it should have a role.
Because last year, all this sterilization took a lot of space in media because of this COVID and how to sterilize PPEs, reusing all these things.
No, you're right. In COVID, they have started using those UV sterilization chambers.
Right.
But it might have some side effects or some bad effects as well. So we have to be more cautious while using a UV sterilization. But as far as the routine laparoscopy is concerned, there is still its role is limited. It might come up in the years.
Okay.
So coming on to the electrocautery, it can be a monopolar current, a bipolar current. I have a few videos in which I'll show you how the monopolar cautery is used and how or where we use a bipolar cautery. But you have to be very cautious regarding the insulation failure, because the plastic sheath which is there over the metallic part of the instrument, that should be there should not be any breach in that plastic sheath, otherwise it can cause insulation failure. and it can cause injury to the organs. And there is another device which is called a harmonic knife. Harmonic knife, it's a, again a different concept from electrocautery, in which there are two blades, and the lower blade, it moves vigorously over the upper blade, and with that friction it generates heat and it cuts and coagulates the organ at the same time. So that vibration is, they say, around 50,000 times in a second. So you can just imagine the speed with which the blades vibrate, and then they generate heat and coagulate and cut at the same time. So thank you very much. I think I have a few videos as well. So we can see a few videos and then we can start with the discussion part. Yes. Is it okay, Professor Sani? Or
yes, sir. Yes, please.
Yeah. Okay. Just give me a second, Adla. Yes. For the videos.
Yeah, open it, it will run. Just go open it on the top.
Okay. Okay.
So
yeah, Professor, can you see it?
Yes.
Yeah. So this is a case of acute cholecystitis, that is the inflammation in the gallbladder, and pancreatitis. So because of the inflammation of the pancreas, there are very many adhesions around that subhepatic space and the gallbladder. So we're using a monopolar current. Can you appreciate the, yeah. So there I'm trying to burn the omentum and take it off the gallbladder. So this monopolar cautery is quite effective while doing these surgical procedures like a cholecystectomy, in which you can have those short bursts of current and you can separate the organs and you can reduce the omentum. So these are, there you can see, this is the gallbladder, this is the cystic duct, there is this common bile duct somewhere here. Although it's not a very easy case to demonstrate, but the idea was just to show you how the monopolar, this is again a monopolar current, the gallbladder is being separated from the liver bed. So okay, there you can see the gallbladder, this is the gallbladder, it is being separated from the liver bed. So again a monopolar current.
So monopolar. So what is the return electrode? Where is the return electrode for this?
Pardon?
Where is the return electrode for this?
The electrode is attached to this instrument, the electrocautery. It has a lead. The instrument at the handle, it has an electrode in which you can place that cord, and that cord goes to the generator.
Okay.
And once you have a foot pedal, and once you activate that foot pedal, you are able to generate the electrode.
So generally, when we do electrocautery, there are two electrodes. One is the electrode through which current is delivered, and other one which is the return, maybe at the thigh or somewhere, the larger electrode. Is it placed there?
Yeah. That is called the patient plate. The patient plate is attached to the patient,
okay,
to the thigh or the calf region of and we separate the patient, and that helps us in generating or in, so that is one, that is one surgery. Coming on to the next, I'll show you just a second, see what is there. Sorry, I can't open up this. We'll come to another, I think. Yeah, this is another interesting case of a diaphragmatic hernia. Many of you might have heard of, you know what diaphragm is, the diaphragm. And this large intestine has herniated into the diaphragm through a hole in the diaphragm, and the bowel has migrated into the chest. So this was because of a traumatic injury which the patient had sustained during an accident, and this has led to a breach in the diaphragm and led to this whole chunk of bowel going into the thorax. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to reduce the bowel and replace it back into the abdomen. This is a omentum along with the various vessels which have also migrated into the chest. And with the help of, I just wanted to show the harmonic knife, we'll cut off. There you, the reduction has been completed. This is the harmonic. So with the harmonic, it cuts and operates at the same time. So as you can see, these are two blades. The lower one is mobile, so it vibrates. The upper one has, as you can see, a white pad. So that is an insulated pad. So there you can see that defect in the diaphragm. This is the spleen. This is the spleen. This is the diaphragmatic defect. And this is the thorax. Yeah, now you're inside the thorax. These are the lungs. So as you can see, because of the pressure, the lung is compressed. So once we deflate it and inflate the lungs, it will come back to normal. So this is the lung. This is the left lung. This is the left lung. So now we'll just stitch the defect and place a mesh. So that is called diaphragmatic hernia repair.
Once the lung has detached from the surrounding wall, I forget what it is called, then it should have deflated completely. Once the lung detaches from its pleura.
Pleura, yeah.
Then it should deflate automatically, right?
Yeah, it does. In this case, since we required space, so we're doing a single lung ventilation. Single lung ventilation is that the endotracheal tube is placed into the right bronchus only, and the air doesn't go to the left lung, so that we have enough space to see any injury in the lung or any injury in the thoracic cavity. So once the procedure is over, so we change over to a, you know, a single lumen endotracheal tube, and then we inflate the left lung as well.
How is that inflation performed?
You just place the endotracheal tube at the, you know, just at the level of carina, so that whatever air you are giving goes to both the lungs. So once you go beyond the carina into the right bronchus, so that leads to a single lung ventilation.
So what is this metal mesh? What was there in that last part?
This is a polypropylene material, which is called proline mesh, or a dual mesh. There are kinds of meshes which has a gelatinous material on one side and polypropylene on one side, and you can have a plain proline mesh, and then you can have a PTFE mesh. So preferred material is of course a polypropylene with a gelatinous material, and that gelatinous material comes in contact with the bowel and the bowel doesn't get stuck to it. And these are the titanium clips which we had applied. So these are the, they call them tackers. So you tack this mesh to the diaphragm or the abdominal wall, and after that you inflate the lungs. I'll show you one more video, which this is again a rather complex surgery, but the idea is to see the bipolar. This is NSEAL. NSEAL is a very advanced kind of a bipolar instrument in which it has two blades. So the difference is with the lateral thermal spread. So if we talk about a unipolar cautery, the lateral thermal spread is almost up to 8 to 10 millimeters. But in a bipolar cautery, it becomes as low as around 5 to 6 millimeters. And with a harmonic, it comes down to around 3 to 4 millimeters. So this is the harmonic. You can see that white pad and the lower blade which moves. So in these kind of complex surgeries, you require a bipolar, you require a harmonic as well. This surgery is actually a laparoscopic sacrocolpopexy. These are actually complex medical terms. This patient was operated for a hysterectomy around 10 years back. The uterus has been removed. And this is the vaginal vault. The vault is, in fact, the roof of the vagina that remains. But the problem with this patient was that the whole thing prolapsed into the perineum. It came down. So she was having a lot of difficulty in sitting. So what we are trying to do is, we are trying to fix that roof of vagina to the sacrum. This is the sacral promontory. This is the tailbone that you call it. This is the rectum. So what I'm trying to do is, I'm trying to make a space between the rectum and the sacrum. So this is the bone. This is the bone. This is the rectum, and this is the pararectal fat. So there is an avascular plane between the rectum and the sacrum. So you have to go in between that plane and make a space and fix a mesh to the bone, and then take out that roof of the vagina, which you call it the vault, and fix the vault to the mesh or the bone. So this is the intestine. As you can see, this is the rectum. So this is almost done. Here you can see the mesh. This is the vault. So we are fixing the mesh to the vault by making a Y, so that the anterior and posterior walls of the vault are fixed and pulled up. The idea is to pull up the wall so that it doesn't prolapse. So again, you require good amount of suturing. So you'd have a sound surgical technique, and it comes with practice, because this is part of an advanced laparoscopic procedure. So I'm using a polypropylene material. It's called Proline 20. So with this, you fix the vault. And again with that tacker, this is called a tacker. You tack, yeah, you can see these titanium clips. So tack the mesh to the sacrum. So this is the bone, this is the vault, and this is the rectum. So we'll close the peritoneum. How can you appreciate the ureter on the right side? The peristalsis of the ureter, you can see. We'll just close and re-peritonealize so that the mesh becomes retroperitoneal. There we're closing the peritoneum and restoring the normal anatomy. So here we used a monopolar cautery, a bipolar cautery, as well as a harmonic. So this completes the surgical part. Close cover. So I'm finished up with the videos. I think all the questions will come. Any questions?
Yes, students, if you have any questions, please ask.
Hello, sir. I have a question regarding the motion of the organs when it comes near to diaphragm or cardiac. How difficult will it be to operate something like laparoscopic, which are very sensitive in motions?
Yeah, that's a very valid question, because once you are operating upon a organ which is continuously moving, like as you said, a diaphragm which is continuously moving with breathing, or let's say any organ which is very close to the heart, it becomes technically even more difficult. So you have to have a very sound surgical expertise to operate upon such kind of organs. So your movements have to be very precise so that you don't end up injuring a major vessel. You don't end up, you know, passing the needle through and through into the heart. So all these things have to be taken care of, and they come with experience. And of course, your surgical expertise is required to perform such kind of advanced laparoscopic surgeries.
So when the new laparoscopic surgeon is trained at that time, do they train on some mannequins or with the experienced doctors?
The various ways in which laparoscopic surgeon gets trained, we have manipulators, we have those mannequins as well, we have those it's kind of a box with a camera fitted inside, and there are holes on both the sides, and you can see the camera and, you know, apply a few sutures, and there are various exercises which they give, like lifting a block, lifting a needle, lifting a ring, placing it into a, you know, various games, just like a game. You pick up a ring and place it somewhere else. So these are various exercises that you undergo while doing laparoscopic training. and it's at a later stage that you get a chance to operate upon.
So there is a lot of talk about robotic surgeries at this, many of the companies like Stryker, Philips, I think they have even opened quite a lot of divisions in robotic surgery. So can you guide us, what is that role in laparoscopy?
See, robotic surgery is it's nothing different from a normal routine laparoscopic surgery. The only difference is that while doing the laparoscopic surgery, my hand movement is like this. So I won't be able to, you know, do it like this or like this. So a robot, the robotic arm, the flexibility is more. You can reach at places where a normal hand movement cannot reach, where a needle holder cannot go into deep into the pelvis. And the movement becomes a little more precise. But you have to have a good amount of training. And again, one thing more, the partial tactile sensation that we were talking about in the PPT, even that partial tactile sensation goes off with the robot. Because you are sitting in another room and operating upon a patient which is there in the OR. So even that partial tactile sensation goes off. But you do get a three-dimensional view because that's a 3D view that you get on a Da Vinci robot. But the cost of surgery goes tremendously high. First, while they call it docking. So once the patient is under anesthesia, you put in the normal ports as you do in any laparoscopic surgery. And then you shift the robot. These robotic arms, generally there are 2 to 3 robotic arms. So they are, the hand instruments are fixed into those robotic arms. Like in one robotic arm, there'll be a harmonic device. In one robotic arm, there'll be a grasper. In one robotic arm, there'll be a scissors. So all these robotic arms are docked into the patient. And then you go to another room. And then you start operating those, performing with those robotic arms. But this docking part takes around 1 to 1.5 hours to, you know, set everything in order. So that requires a lot of time. But of course, in those centers in which they are doing, laparoscopic prostatectomies or laparoscopic, generally deep pelvic surgeries, in which they have around 3 to 4 surgeries lined up so that you do the docking part once for one patient and then one after the other, you keep on doing 3 or 4 surgeries, then it becomes a little more practically possible. But once you have only one surgery, then it becomes a little cumbersome and time consuming. Plus the cost of surgery goes very high because these robots, a robot would cost somewhere around, around 20 crores, 20 to 30 crores. And that single arm would cost you around 1 lakh rupees. And that has to be changed after every 5 cases. So then the cost of surgery becomes extremely high. But it is definitely good for those pelvic surgeries or advanced cancer surgeries where you do very precise dissection. So where even those hand movements are a little jerky, so that stabilizes, the robot stabilizes those movements.
Yes, any other questions, students?
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
So my question is the metal mesh which was used, like it is kept permanently into the patient, yeah, or surgery is performed later to remove it?
It's a polypropylene material which is relatively inert, so it doesn't have to be removed. The removal is indicated only if the material becomes infected. Let's say you have placed a mesh and the patient ends up having fever and pain and swelling in that part. Only then the mesh removal is indicated. Otherwise, it becomes a permanent prosthesis as you have in a, in a knee or a tibia or a femur. You put in a plate and that remains throughout your body.
So one more question, like how you decide whether to go for laparoscopic surgery or open surgery? Like it's patient's call or doctor's call?
I'd play both ways. You give options to to the patient. And of course, the surgeon should be confident enough to perform that procedure laparoscopically. If you are confident that you can do it laparoscopically, then you can consult the patient that these are the options that you have. This is the cost part, which will of course increase with the laparoscopic procedure. But these are the advantages of the procedure for you. You'll have early recovery and lesser amount of pain. Plus, the vision will be more precise. Like we do laparoscopic nephrectomies, removal of the kidneys, removal of the spleens. So even with those small incisions, you can remove bigger organs as well. So again, you consult the patient, and then whatever the patient decides, you follow it.
Good morning, Dr. Parmar. This is Dr. Rajesh, from a faculty member of Biomedical Engineering Department. Maybe a quick couple of questions. Some of your suggestions I would like to know. The one thing you just mentioned, that the robotic arm is supposed to be replaced after every 4 or 5 times of surgery or something like that. What if I understood? So why it is? Why it is done so, that is the one thing. Is it because of some mechanical restrictions of robotic arm or sterilizations or those kind of problem maybe? So that is one thing. And another, in general, in India, can you just give some kind of insight that what kind of surgery is being done with the help of some robots or robotic surgeries in India? So is there some quick light if you can give on this?
Sir, the robotic arms, actually, this is at present, Da Vinci robot has the monopoly throughout the world. And they have decided the rates. They have decided the rates of the arms as well. And it all depends. The various companies, they have their own protocols. Sterilization part, of course, you can re-sterilize these arms. But after those 5 or 6 procedures, because of those, you know, computer settings or whatever it is, it stops functioning. I don't know the reason. The reason could be that the company requires, I mean, company needs the hospital to buy another arm, which will be, you know, more economical for the company and a little less economical for the patient in the hospital. So there are so many other reasons it might be involved. But after those 5-6 procedures, the arm stops functioning and you have to procure a new arm. So that is the company's policy. And secondly, the kind of procedures which are being done, the commonest is a laparoscopic prostatectomy for cancer of the prostate. The reason being is that, as I said, that it is a little difficult to reach the pelvis, because in a male, the pelvis is very narrow. And if you think of doing it as an open procedure, it becomes extremely cumbersome to, you know, reach that narrow pelvis. But with laparoscopic surgery, it becomes a little better. But with a robot, the movements or your dissection becomes extremely precise. So almost in, I would say, 70-80% of the patients are those CA prostate patients. The other patients are like a laparoscopic hysterectomy for malignancy, in which you want to do pelvic lymph node dissections. Again, being a narrow part of the abdomen, it becomes a little cumbersome to reach those areas. So robot makes it more precise to sample those lymph nodes and take care of the various vessels and lymphatics in that region. So these are the two surgeries for which the robots are being used. They have a robot in PJ also. So it is with the Department of Urology and Gynecology. So these are the two procedures that they are doing at PGI. At present, I think these are the two procedures. But of course, with time, the applicability will increase. But again, the cost remains a constraint for the patient and the institute as well.
Right. Great. Thank you, Dr. Parmar.
So,
yeah.
All press Sunny. So we should.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you for your time. And I hope students have benefited from Dr. Parmar's talk. And his hospital is the most a well-known and well-respected hospital in Ropert. So many of the students have still not come to Ropert, even though they have enrolled since last 1 year. So they don't even know, they didn't have, don't have even come to IIT Ropert campus. So hope when you come, then you visit this hospital. Last year, we every last 2 years we have been organizing tours of Dr. Parmar's hospital. This time we could not. Maybe next year we will.
Yeah. Do. Right, sir. Looking forward to it.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. Yeah. Yes, sir.
Thanks a lot.